Yeah, my name is Jakob Bjerg Larsen, and I work at the Danish Association of the Pharmaceutical Industry, in Danish abbreviated to LIF. And I work with pharmaceutical policy, and especially within clinical trials and pharmaceutical manufacturing, but also the broader research policy, and of course also use of health data and industry interest in use of health data. Yes, a little bit about the agenda for my talk, a little bit more about LIF and about developing pharmaceutical products, and also about the company's use of data when they develop products. And I'll also give two examples of the potential for companies using biobank material and the interest and and the potential in doing it. And then, of course, the main part about the Danish life science strategy and the focus on health data. And finally, a couple of suggestions or ideas how to boost or increase the use of health data and especially the industry use of biobank material. Yes. LIF is the voice of the pharmaceutical industry in Denmark, and we represent the R&D-based pharmaceutical industry. There are other pharmaceutical companies also on the market, but not doing R&D. We are 38 members, both Danish manufacturers, the big Danish companies, but also foreign affiliates are members. And here on the slide, you can see the logos and names of all the companies. And we have a vision or a mission is that we work to ensure that the pharmaceutical industry has the best possible conditions to develop, market, distribute, and provide information on medicinal products, and to ensure that patients have extensive fast access to the best medical treatment. So that's what we are doing and trying to do. So so we are a lobby organization and mainly focusing on the framework conditions here in Denmark. When we try to evaluate to what extent we are fulfilling our vision or mission, we also look around Europe and we try to make an international benchmark. And for that purpose, we have created a tool or you could say an index measuring pharma industry specialization. And our aspiration when using this tool is that we want to maintain Denmark in top three in Europe. And we measure this pharma industry specialization using five parameters. We look at the amount of pharmaceutical production, and we look at the amount of export of medicine and the number of people being employed in the pharma industry in Denmark, and the number of industry-funded clinical trials, and also the amount of investment in life science research in total. And when we combine those five parameters, then we come out second. We came out second in 2020, and that is good, of course, no doubt about that. But previous years, we have actually been number one. So Belgium is now taking the lead. So we would, of course, like to go back on the first place. But we have to work on that. Then a few words about the developing a pharmaceutical product. On this slide, I have tried to mark all the stages involved in the whole process from early research up here, and then to the development, and then to also the to post-approval phases down here. So here you can see the whole journey going from research to market. And I want you to pay attention to two things on this slide. That is that when you develop a pharmaceutical product, it requires very, very close collaboration between private companies and public parties, meaning universities and hospitals, because there's no single part that can lift this task of developing a pharmaceutical product. And collaboration is really key and vital. And in yellow, I have marked the stages where you have a lot of public involvement in the development. So you have a lot of public involvement here in the basic research through the clinical phases. You do it in public hospitals. You have the authorities. And when you do the later clinical trials and the whole pharmacovigilance and follow-up is very much driven also by public involvement and public agencies. So you really have to this collaboration in order to make it work. And then it's also important, the same thing is that use of health data in general, both biobank material and register data, is the use of that is widespread all over those different stages, or nearly all of them. And on this next slide, I will try to elaborate a little bit about that, how we use data throughout these phases. Here you can see the different, you can say, development stages and use stages. And when you use biobank material, it is especially relevant in the basic research for clinical development. And here you use the biobank material to explore disease pathology, identify biomarkers, study disease incidences, prevalences, patterns, and so on. And then when you go down to the clinical research, then the health data can also map patient populations. It can accelerate patient recruitment, feasibility studies, and so on. And maybe also, in some cases, replace or supplement phase four trials. And maybe also in the future, it's almost beginning a little now, that you can use health data as an extra arm in doing randomized clinical trials. So it's really important here. And when you do the regulatory work, having the marketing authorization, you also use health data. For instance, patient recorded outcome data is part of the marketing authorization application. Real world data is the basis for label expansions. And also real world data hold information on safety when pregnant, which also comes into the label. Going to pharmacovigilance, you use the real world data to follow up on specific safety reports. And here we know from our company that we especially use global data. Danish data is not used so much. And I guess that's a shame because it really holds a lot of potential and information. But right now it's more global data being used. And when you go to the use market side, of course, you can also use data for comparative effectiveness studies, cost of illness, and so on. And when you go down to the clinical implementation here, the health data can also improve that and facilitate that. And also, for instance, it can facilitate evaluation of innovative price agreements. If you, for instance, start to make the price based on the clinical outcome of the drug in real life, then you have to have health data in order to evaluate what kind of price should then be paid for the drug. And this is also something that is coming up. Yes, on the next two slides, I will briefly introduce two examples or cases that demonstrate that biobank material really holds a great potential for development of new treatments and new medicines. But it also demonstrates that pharma companies, they have a big interest in this public-private partnership and collaboration. So the first is Isaac, and that's a Danish research project founded in 2012. And the purpose of this project is to find causes and create basis for better treatment and prevention of five very severe mental disorders, autism, ADHD, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and depression. And it's a really big project. More than 130,000 Danes are involved in this project. Their biosamples are being used in the product, in this project. And they explore the interaction between genetic factors and other environmental risk factors when developing a mental disorder. And a lot of different perspectives and methods are being used, and focusing on genes and cells and animal models, population studies, and so on. And you can say that it's, yeah, one of the largest studies of its kind, and a lot of researchers involved in it. And it's supported by the Lundbeck Foundation, and have a quite substantial budget. On the right side, I have highlighted some of the results of this project, and it's just to illustrate the huge potential, because these basic results can also be used as the basis for developing medicine. And it's also relevant for companies when they would like to develop new medicines. So, and you can find more results on the ISAC homepage. Here, it's just a little, a few examples. There are really many publications coming out of this program. But a few of them is that, for instance, they found out that autism and ADHD share the same genes, and also the same changes in the genes. So it's a bit about how the biology behind these diseases are. They also found out that anorexia is not only a psychological disorder, but it's also a metabolic disorder. So it's also important if you want to develop new medicine that you know that. They also found out that its specific gene is associated with increased risk of cannabis abuse. So the whole concept of abuse, and if you should be able to find some way to treat that, I think you could you can find some relevant insights here. And finally, they also find that 30 genes are associated with bipolar disorder. It's also something about the disease mechanisms. So it's just to show that these very basic results can also be relevant for pharma companies going into these areas. And then FinGen, we have already touched upon it several times today. So I won't go into all the details. So it's, yeah, this large project started in 2017, and where they collect a lot of, or analyze a lot of biosamples, making genome analysis on 500,000 biobank participants in Finland. And they combine the information from the genome analysis with the health data also registered in the health system in Finland. And of course, they try to find these basic mechanisms, give new medical insights into a wide variety of areas. And I guess it's one of the very first personalized medicine projects in this scale. And it's quite unique also because you have this public-private collaboration. And it really brings together public actors, among others, universities, hospitals, biobanks, and then these 13 international pharma companies and the Finnish population. And when you see when the funding, you had Business Finland putting in 20 million euros, and you have the pharma companies putting 65 million euros. So it's really a big project. And you can here see by also the financing part that the industry is quite interested in such a project. And over here on the right side, it's taken from the FinGen homepage. So you can see that the idea is to deepen the understanding about origins of diseases and their treatment, and also to be able to prioritize in drug targets based on genomic information. And here's the industry interest in this. And again, the pharma companies and the parties in the project get a head start, 12 months where they can use the data. And then afterwards, data are shared with the wider community, and data release are being done twice a year. So it's just, again, an example that industry is interested in going into these kind of collaborations. So the question is just, how do we set up a system that makes that possible also in Denmark? So that brings me to the Danish life science strategy. And just to set the scene, the starting point of this life science strategy is very, very positive, because we have seen a really big, a huge growth in the Danish life science sector over the last 10, 15 years. Economic growth, as well as also growth in the number of employees. And it's a growth that has especially been driven by pharma companies and biotech companies. And I guess right now, or last year, if you take the export of goods in Denmark, then pharmaceutical makes out, I guess it's little above 20% of all the goods being exported out of Denmark is pharmaceuticals. So it has really grown, and it is really, really big. And we would, of course, like this growth to continue. And this is also therefore we're happy that we have this life science strategy. But also at this point, I would like to stress that when we talk about the life science sector, we see it as an, you can say, public-private ecosystem that is much larger than just private companies. And I guess that's quite important. This is not a strategy for the life science industry. It's a strategy for the life science sector. So both private and public parties in this ecosystem can become better. And it's also because that if we need to have better treatments and innovations and so on, we need to get both parties involved and activated, and also being able to collaborate. Yes. Now, better use of health data, that is a key component in this life science strategy. And on the left side, you can see the vision stated in the life science strategy related to better use of health data. And it says that Denmark should have a leading international position using health data for research, development, and public authority task in an up-to-date, innovative, and secure way. So that's the vision, and fully agree. And I think all of us in here can agree that that's a good vision. And on the right side of the slide, I have shown to you all the 38 initiatives that are in this life science strategy. And in red here, I have circled in all the initiatives related to better use of health data. So it's part of this broader strategy. So one of the key health data initiatives in the strategy is a new called Research Health Data Gateway, En Indgang til Sundhedsdata in Danish. And it's, you can say, a one point of entry website. And this new gateway consists of three separate initiatives. And it's not yet in full operation, but you could say the structural elements are in place now. So it consists on a guidance function, meaning that if you want to start up a project where you have to use health data, biobank material, or register data, you can access this point and then get some help and guidance on how to start your project. And that is aimed both at public researchers and companies. So here you can have the starting guidance. Then you also have a metadata map. And this is a map where you can see, where can I find all the data? And where are biobank material? Where are register data? So you go in one place, and then you can see, where do I find all the different things that I needed in my project? And when you then have formulated your project and you want to apply for access to data, could be biobank material or health data in general, then you can go into this part of the gateway, and here you can find all the relevant information on how you make the application, so you can get guidance in that way. So of course that's something that we think is a very good thing, and it's really good starting point to make it easier you can say, for outsiders and newcomers to start to work with the Danish ecosystem within this area. And we, of course, look forward to see it in full operation in the coming years. Other key initiatives on health data. There is a national partnership being established, and referring to the discussions this morning about if it should be headed by the Ministry of Health or by the Ministry of Commerce or who should be doing it. It is very good that this national partnership is headed by the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Commerce jointly. So we also have the ministry, the top level in the government, and the ministries, the relevant ministries at the table, together with all the stakeholders involved in dealing with health data in general. So I think it's a really good forum where we can discuss the framework and the challenges and so on going on within this area. So, and actually we're having a meeting tomorrow morning. So that'll be the second meeting in this forum. So I'm looking forward to that. Then there'll also be creation of a secure national platform for analyzing health data, providing access to supercomputing facilities, also for external partners and also for industry partners. So I think that's also a very good thing. And then you have the international promotion. There's also initiatives focusing on that. Invest in Denmark, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and the Danish Health Data Agency should join together and do some promotional activities also aimed at the international audience, international scientists, and also pharma companies, for instance. And on the right side, I have also highlighted that key public stakeholders, they have actually joined forces also to create a joint vision for collaboration internally on better use of health data. And from an industry perspective, I think it's quite important. It's not part of the life science strategy, but it's something that the public sector key stakeholders have come together and make this vision. And I think it's really important that authorities and registry owners collaborate and coordinate all the different initiatives going on, and also key that these key actors also commit themselves to make progress in this area. So that is really good. Then finally, a few words or reflection ideas on how to boost the use of biobank material in Denmark, and turning this these potential and this industry interest into projects going on in Denmark. And we also talked about this morning that it could be a long journey, and you cannot change everything from day one. But I think we can do something in order to get this this process going. And as Frederik from Novartis told us, there are very, very little industry use of Danish biobanks today. And I guess it's a shame, because you have a huge potential. And as I just showed you that, the biobanks hold a huge potential for doing research that can support the development of new medicines. So it should be done. And we would, of course, like to see more industry use of the biobanks, because it will, at the very end, benefit patients, and not only patients located in Denmark, but if Danish biobank material could be the basis for developing new medicines, it can actually benefit patients all over the world. Also just to the fact that, we're exporting all over the world, and the companies that I represent is marketing their products all over the world. So how to proceed? I have three ideas, you can say. On the right side, I have borrowed a slide from Lasse, a presentation that you made, and here you can see how pharma companies and foreign scientists can get access to biobank material, and you can also see that collaboration with local scientists, that is the key, because they are the gateway into getting access to the biobank material. So collaboration is key, but it's also the hard part. So therefore, I think that, and of course you could say, there are very, very good reasons for companies and foreign sciences to collaborate with local scientists in Denmark, because I think it also makes research better. It's good to have local knowledge of the biological material included in your project. It's good to have knowledge about the local system, the local healthcare system, the local society in which the biobank material is collected. It provides a lot of additional value to the project. So it's good. But the problem is, how do you find a local researcher to collaborate with? That's the bottleneck, I think. When you come from outside, it's hard to find the right research environments. So I think if you could make some kind of matchmaking functionality, that would be very relevant. And maybe you could get some inspiration from TriNation, because they have actually made this matchmaking functionality between companies wanting to collaborate with hospital clinicians on clinical trials. And you could maybe do some of the same thing in this area. And of course, you should also have incentives and capacity for the Danish scientists to collaborate with industry. So you should also think about that, how to create incentives and capacity to actually do it and collaborate when companies try and come to you and say, I would like to do this research. And then increase awareness and knowledge, yes. Reach out to industry nationally and internationally, and we would like to help to do that. Showcase the concrete results, show what can be done, and also look what have other countries done. For instance, Finland, how do they reach out to companies? Because we can see that some of the projects are going on there, and companies would like to come and work with the Finnish biobanks. But how have they done that? And maybe also the private biobanks, they also communicate with their customers. How do they do that? How do they attract attention? And you have already made this Danish National Biobank, and it's also a way of showing what is possible and that thesis feasibility. And my last slide then is reduce the administrative barriers and regulatory uncertainty. I guess that is quite important. Because I think right now the thinking is that getting access to Danish biobank material that is complicated, slow, and not transparent. And if you are a private company, a researcher sitting outside Denmark or even outside Europe, it becomes very, very difficult. And the implementation of GDPR, it has not been helpful. GDPR in itself, I guess, is not a problem. It's okay that the regulation is complicated. But the problem is that it's unclear, you have lack of guidance, and you have different interpretations. Pharma industry is used to handle complicated regulation, so it's the uncertainty. So right now, if you can lower the administrative barriers and the regulatory uncertainty, then you can do something about the lack of transparency and also the improve the speed, which is important for pharma companies when they want to set up projects. So I guess that was all for me.